lawnmower, man. Not another step, I just finished it, Kevin shouted from his front porch, pointing with a pair of scissors in his hand. Benson held as still as he could on the sidewalk before Kevin's house, before his lawn, recognizing that strange abstraction in Kevin's face, a mania that he had seen many times before, a mania that could only mean one thing. He was working in his yard again. For only a moment, he thought he saw Kevin drooling out of his slacked jaw as he stood up there on his porch, scissors pointing toward the sidewalk, his face fixed rigidly, glistening with perspiration, and a chopped blade of grass stuck to his mustache. Finally, he broke it, stepping from his porch and onto the sandstone pathway. Each stone settled with gingerly precision so as not to allow any weeds to grow through, avoiding any abstraction, mistake, or imperfection. It was a geometric masterpiece that Kevin thought akin to an Alex Gray painting, and it was right there between his lawn and his driveway. He took a stance next to his friend and neighbor on the sidewalk, scissors in one hand and a cold beer in the other. "Hold this," he told Benson. Benson took his beer and Kevin pulled another cold can from the pocket of his cargo shorts, trading it back for his own. "Yard work, Ian?" "Every day. Come down here, nice and flat on the sidewalk with me." Benson watched as Kevin sunk into prone position on the sidewalk so as to be eye level with his freshly cut grass, his lime green running shoes that were once white hanging above his ass as so as not to disturb the grass on the park strip in all its perfection. Benson joined him, and they looked across the even gradient of Kevin's lawn. "You see that?" Kevin said as he extended a scissor hand and snipped a blade that looked as though it might not match the even grade. "If you could put a leveler over that, just over the top of the lawn, a leveler that was as light as a feather, do you know what it would tell you?" "It would tell you that it's goddamn perfect, Benson. Completely perfect." He stood up and Benson followed, finding Kevin's arms around his shoulder, feeling the hot moisture which emanated from his armpits. He shuddered for a moment, a strange and cold feeling beneath the midday's July sun. "You've really done it again," Benson told him. "You're goddamn right I have. And look at this. See that shit? See those lines? See that perfect crosshatch of diagonal and horizontal lines? I tell you, I could have been a mathematician. Could have been an architect with those lines, and it was all just by eye. That's a goddamn Picasso right there, I'll tell you what." Benson studied them for a long while, looking at the perfect juxtaposition of diagonal and horizontal lawnmower lines. Kevin was right. It looked damn good. Similar to the ones in his own yard, three doors down. But he knew he could never match that precision, meeting 45-degree parallel after 45-degree parallel. He couldn't even make out the perimeter that Kevin had started with. Couldn't even see the lines from where the mower was turned. "I'll tell you," Kevin went on, "it's a hell of a lot better than what the Brady's got going on across the street. Looks like their son had just finished his first day of hair school. A real hack job. Then he just leaves those extra clippings scattered all over his sidewalk and driveway, all over his lawn, Benson. And for what? So they can dry up and rot? Yeah, sure, that looks good. Then do you know what happens when the wind blows? It comes right over here, and I have to rake the grass and sweep the cement all over again. I don't like raking my grass, Benson. It ruins those perfect lines. Bunch of white trash hillbillies, I'll tell you." Benson moved uncomfortably from foot to foot, hating the way his friend's moisture seemed to evaporate from the crevices of his body and into his own nose. It was like farting in the shower with all the steam, Benson thought with disgust. Benson always just used a leaf blower, mindlessly letting his grass clippings get carried away down the street. More than the Brady's, sure, but not at all as meticulous as Kevin with his kitchen broom and dustpan. Kevin stayed silent as he stared at his lawn, his jaw opening dully again, drool building up at his lips' edges. Benson thought he couldn't have heard anything even if he did talk, especially if it had to do with anything outside of the realm of his yard. They looked out at the immaculate masterpiece, shrubs clipped perfectly into geometric shapes, spears and rectangles only. Stones placed in parallel to each other around their trunks, or within the flower bed, which only showed signs of attention and care with its midnight black soil and its color-coded flowers. Whether or not one could say that what Kevin did to his yard could be called love, Benson didn't know. The whole thing looked more akin to a museum with cold, polished edges. But instead of a slap on the wrist for touching anything in his museum, the punishment was, instead, death. "Come into the back," Kevin told him. "I want to show you something." "No, not on the grass. What the hell do you think you're doing? The pathway. Take the pathway." Vincent followed him on the sandstone pathway toward the gate which led them to the back, looking at the wrought iron gate which separated the front from the back and not seeing any sign of rust on it. He'd seen Kevin out there before with this gate and fence, only a few weeks ago, with sandpaper and a can of black paint. It still gleamed under the sun. Kevin opened the gate gently, a tempest brewing over his face as soon as he saw what his son and wife were doing back there. Benson shuddered at what he saw, shrinking in terror at the look of utter despair and rage over his friend's face, wanting to leave just then, wanting to let the tempest blow over for a week or so before he saw any of them again. He beheld the scene of Kevin's wife and son in terror, closing his eyes and taking a deep gulp, not unable, but unwilling to accept the scene which unraveled before him. How could they be so stupid, so terribly mistaken? They are on the lawn. "Sharon," Kevin shouted with a hoarse voice, a spray of saliva following the utterance. "What in God's name, Christ and Satan, what are you doing? How many times have I told you before, the lawn, Sharon, the lawn?" Then, for only a moment, Benson wasn't sure of what he saw on Kevin's face. Had the sweat built up so much around his eyes in that moment? Was he... Oh, God. He hoped he wasn't crying. His son sat there in the shade, his eyes pinned down to a cell phone screen only inches from his face. And Benson wondered if the kid even knew what transpired around him. "Your lawn," Sharon whined with a wrinkled nose. She was a good-looking lady. Benson wasn't at all ashamed to admit that she looked a lot better than his own wife. Still thin and still fine. But Sharon was loud, very loud. And that was what prevented any notion of envy or even desire, especially during those backyard barbecues when she had a little too much wine and thought the other married men in the circle might take her for a better ride than her own husband. Benson thought about the way she'd always seemed to drop something right before him, bending down slowly to get it, or falling over into him or onto him, or the way she always seemed to suggestively eat her hot dogs as she maintained eye contact with him. She stood there with a frown drawn across her face, the wind gently moving her sundress around her fine figure, sunglasses hiding her wicked gaze. "Yeah," she said, "your Christmas bonus really helped us fund this masterpiece." Her monologue was full of finger quotations as she spoke. "Maybe if you stopped obsessing over your stupid little hobby and put your mind to your job, you could have gotten that promotion, and maybe you wouldn't be stuck here, and we could have gotten that apartment downtown, couldn't we? I bet you mow your lawn with a bigger heart on than I've seen in years. When's the last time you got it up in bed, huh?" Kevin stood there, his fists clutched in little balls as he trembled. Sharon looked at him for only a moment longer, that awful sneer ruining her complexion. Then she stormed off, stomping into the house, but not before rubbing her shoes into the grass like a bull before takeoff. "Timmy, go with your mom," Kevin said, with shaky vocals. Benson looked toward his son Timmy, who only watched the screen in front of him, eyes dully fluttering and mouth drawn dumbly open. "Timmy, your mom." "Yeah, okay," Timmy said absently, as though he were a voice recording, unmoving. Kevin walked up to him, stepping delicately over his lawn so as to not make any grooves, only flat prints. Then Timmy yelped when he felt his father's lime-green running shoe meet the side of his ass with a dull thud. The kid had tears flowing down his face in a split second, running and whining his way back into the house. Benson stood there, feeling awkward and shifting from foot to foot again as Kevin lamented over the gouges in his lawn. Then, after a long silence passed, he was about to leave before Kevin sighed a long, attention-grabbing sigh, the way couples will sigh at each other late at night when one has something to talk about. With a movement of pain and discomfort, Benson walked toward his friend and put a hand over his shoulder in an attempt to comfort the tortured man. "Sorry about your lawn," he told him. "I hate my family, Benson. I hate my job, I hate my family, and I hate my life. But I love my yard. Oh, God, how I love my yard." That same rigid, slack-jawed look came over him again as the tempest cleared, and in a moment of horror, Benson thought that he looked more like a mustached skeleton than anything else. A skeleton whose bones were the same lime green as his shoes. "You see my gazebo over there? Damn nice one, I know. It's made from redwoods, and we didn't even have to stain it. Just threw on a clear coat over it. You know the Mannings down on the corner? Theirs is made from aluminum. Cheap bastards. And that grill? See the size of that thing? Could cook for the whole damn circle if I wanted to, but I don't because they'd all step on my damn lawn. Why doesn't anybody understand that a man's yard is his trophy to share with the world? This is my sanctuary, my place of peace. She just doesn't like it because I've finally found something that I really enjoy, that I really love. Something that doesn't involve her. He lifted his gaze from the gouges in his lawn, returning to his friend. Benson, I have to ask you something. You might want to crack open that beer for it, though. No, man, listen, I better get back home, you know. The wife's probably looking for me. He turned away, back toward the gate, but could only make it so far as a gesture. I need you to do something for me. Benson sobbed himself. He couldn't leave the poor man in such desperation, so he cracked his beer with a pop and took the place beside Kevin. Can't get too mad at the bastards, he said, gesturing toward the impressions his wife and child had made. I haven't even mowed back here yet, Benson. Did just about everything, but there's still time. What do you want me to do? I want you to mow me. He paused, eyes navigating Benson's reaction. I want you to mow me right into the lawn. You're the only other person I know who can make the crosshatch look like anything respectable. I love my yard. It's the only thing I truly care about. I want to be part of it. So mow me, man. Mow me right the fuck down and I can be one with the lawn. Yeah, he said, looking off as though caught in a dream. One with the lawn. Kevin, you can't be serious, can you? Kevin only looked up to him solemnly. Benson felt his body turning smaller in the presence of the man in his grass-stained running shoes, wanting nothing more but to leave, sprint right down the street and forget about this whole insane interaction. The yard-obsessed Kevin, his dissatisfied wife, and their dim-witted kid. Jesus, man, he stammered. I don't know about that. He felt the small blow as Kevin put a playful fist into his stomach. What are you, pussy? Huh? Too pussy to mow my lawn? Come on, man. I'll lay right down there in the wide spot. Always get the best lines in that spot. I don't know, man. It's just that... Benson stammered, feeling upset with the way his skin tingled coolly beneath the scorching sun. Fine, Kevin said, a dark shade over his eyes. He shoved past his friend and made him nearly fall onto the lawn. Benson watched as he stormed back to the gate, then carefully stomping on sandstone pavers. Then he was pushing his mower back there, pulling on the cord again and again until it roared to life like some mongrel beast hungry for flesh. Benson only stood there, as though he were unable to move, his eyes widening and his heart pounding in preparation for what his lawn-loving friend was about to do. He watched in stuttering horror as Kevin moved his mower about back and forth so as to be parallel with the white plastic fence. Then he pulled a bungee cord from his cargo shorts, and Benson briefly wondered how many other things he had hiding down there. With quick, frustrated movements, yet cool, calculated logic, Kevin tightened his cord around the gas and acceleration levers on his mower. Then he moved quick, far too quick for Benson to stop him. He could only watch as Kevin ran fast into the wide section of his yard and plopped down on his lawn as the mower, with its acceleration tied down, came blaring after him. It hit his feet first with a maniac sound like thousands of celery sticks breaking in jagged patterns, but it wasn't nearly as loud as Kevin's lunatic cackle. Yes, that's it. The perfect line. Oh God, yes. He bayed as the greasy green blades came chopping to his knees. Benson couldn't bear to watch, yet his body seemed paralyzed, fixated on the blood and tendrils and gore which sprayed all around. It's like an orgasm, Benson thought madly in consideration of Sharon's whining. Then the blades were coming over his hips, and Benson could see the gruesome spaghetti remains of his feet and legs, still twitching like some wild animal on the side of the road. Benson thought that he must have blacked out at some point, or the tunnel vision had entirely corroded the summer evening before him, because he couldn't recall the mower spinning over Kevin's head and neck. He remembered the way his arms savagely whipped back and forth on the mower's sides like some maniac cartoon, before they were sucked down and under, and then no doubt spit into the canvas collector bag. He could only guess when Kevin's neck and head were severed and mangled into some wild, scrambled state by the sound of his orgasming screams and the stretching of his vocal cords. They first sounded hoarse and then ravaged, but then they were stretched out, ascending into a high and impossible pitch before taking on the sound of the mower itself. The mower drifted after it had mingled his skull, gently gliding along the dark green grass until it stopped softly at the fence line. Benson looked at the remains. Benson looked at the remains, a wild mess of color vomit amongst jagged green-stained bone fragments, gourd pasta, and the yellow pus shade of his stomach innards. He turned and vomited into the lawn's impression where Sharon had been sitting moments before. Then he looked at the line of cut grass through Kevin's mangled corpse. It was a damn fine one, too. Maybe the straightest Kevin had ever cut. If you made it all the way to the end, then thank you for listening. Please like and subscribe so I can get this channel going and post more horror. Thank you.